ఆర్గనైజ్డ్ బై కురుక్షేత్ర పనోరమాన్ సైన్స్ సెంటర్ అండ్ వింగ్స్ ఆఫ్ ఏరో ఇన్ కొలాబరేషన్ విత్ వింగ్స్ ఆఫ్ ఏరో అండ్ ద ఫ్యాకల్టీ మెంబర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ డిపార్ట్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఏరోస్పేస్ ఇంజనీరింగ్ చండీగఢ్ యూనివర్సిటీ అండ్ ఫర్ డే టు ఐ మీన్ టుడే వీఆర్ సెలబ్రేటింగ్ ద సెకండ్ డే ఆఫ్ ద ఇంటర్నేషనల్ స్పేస్ వీక్ విచ్ ఈస్ బీయింగ్ హెల్డ్ ఫ్రమ్ అక్టోబర్ 4th టు 10th అక్టోబర్ అండ్ టుడే వీఆర్ టాకింగ్ అబౌట్ డిజైన్ అండ్ డెవలప్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ హైబ్రిడ్ హెల్ ఎయిర్షిప్ So I would like to welcome faculty members from Department of Aerospace, Chandigarh University. So I think Mr. Shivam Suri is going to present, right?
Yes, sir. He is going to present.
Yeah. Yeah. Over to Mr. Shivam Suri. Please kindly deliver your lecture.
Thank you very much, sir. So, good evening to one and all present here. My name is Shivam Suri and we are Team Aero Indians. First of all, we would like to thank Kurukshetra Panorama and Science Center, Ministry of Culture, and in collaboration with Wings of Aero. We are very thankful to present this lecture on design and development of hybrid HAL airship. So, these are our team members. So, I would like to start with the problem statement first. So the problem statement or the design challenge that we had been put up with, that was actually we had to design a high altitude, long endurance aerial platform, or in short, we can say HALEAP. The key focus in that design was that it should be able to stay airborne for throughout the year for around 12 months, and it will move between four locations, and provided that it should carry 100 kg dedicated payloads. And it should be able to provide cater continuous power requirements. And it should not have any refueling options on board. So this is the basic problem statement that we were put up with. And now I would like to start how we assess the problem and how we went on to look up for the solutions that we can achieve. So starting from the Delhi, so it was the takeoff that should be started from Delhi. So it should stay in Delhi from 31st December to 25th March. Then it should travel within 5 days to each cities, and it should travel likewise. So in each cities, it will stay for around 3 months, and it relocates within 5 days. So that is the constraints that we had to put in mind. So now comes the roadmap assessment, that how we started working on the problem. So first of all, this is the roadmap based on our timelines, how we did some work. First of all, we did the analysis of problem statement. And after analysis, what we found out that there is no such design existing which can have a huge amount of range and endurance as well. So for example, if you want to keep an aircraft for 1 year, so you need to do some brainstorming of innovative ideas from the very basic phase. So we, after analyzing some literature surveys we had done, what we found out that we could go for either UAV airship or hybrid airships, which we'll talk about later. So the basic concept was that we started working on existing designs, and then we went on with some conventional aircraft design processes, and coming to a final solution, we did some simulations of the design. Then we did some detailed calculation of aerodynamics, propulsion parameters, and then we came to a final report. So this is the key challenges that we assessed. So what was the key challenges that was required in the design? So first of all was the weight estimation, because whenever we start designing a airplane or in any aircraft design process, first we have to do the weight estimation. So we had to keep in mind all the aspects like the aerodynamics, the propulsion, the structure, aerodynamic, avionics, and the materials. So after assessing the weight estimation, we took the gross weight to be around 1327 kgs. And for giving the best aerodynamic profile to the wing, we had to take optimum value of a CL profile. So for that, we have taken E231 airfoil, which we'll talk about it later. So next thing is the suitable wingspan that is required, because we have either UAV or airship. We need a sufficient amount of lift to carry the platform for 1 year, and we should require very little amount of propulsion energy so that we can consume more fuel and we can put up for 1 year without any need for refueling. The next parameter was the wing shape selection, because it plays a very important role in drag estimation. We had to estimate the drags also, because it is the key factor in the aerodynamics. If we do not estimate how much drag it would possess, so for example, if we have estimated the lift and we have not estimated the drag, so we might get the lift but drag as well. So these all are the related parameters, so we have to calculate all of that, and we have to keep that in mind. And the most important parameter is that we have to keep the structure to be light, durable, and cost effective. And remember, cost effective is a very important point. We had to provide appropriate wing location so that it would be maneuverable and it would be easy to control. And the required wing dihedral and the required rigidity should be maintained as well. And next on, we went to consider about the fuselage. Fuselage important parameters comes in mind is the it is shape and size. So in size, we talk about the slenderness ratio, which is the ratio of its length to its width. So we had to take all these parameters in mind, since all these parameters affect the aerodynamics and it will affect the lift and drag estimations as well. So we did some calculations, then we found out the load factor and wing loading. Wing loading is basically the total lift generated by the body divided by its total gross weight. And now next thing is, which we had to finalize, is that the number and type of propulsion units we will be using. So that was very important, because since we all know, the problem statement stated that this design, the platform should be in between 15 to 20 kilometer altitude, which is in stratosphere region. And since we know that stratosphere region has very low density, so we had to keep in mind that we cannot use turboprop engines. So we had to take all those parameters and considerations in mind. So this is our work distribution. We worked in such a manner that we could brainstorm new ideas and cross-verify each other's statements before going further. So since it was a conceptual stage, we had to look at all the aspects. And this is how we have done the problem statement. This is a brief overview and how we came to a solution. So first, we found out that we need a long endurance. And long endurance, I mean, it should be for 1 year. So, and the next thing is the flight path. How should the platform travel within a city? So for example, if it is staying in Delhi for 3 months, it should be there for 3 months, and we need to optimize the flight path so that we require very less amount of fuel and it could stay in an optimal parametric conditions. Next thing was the power generation and utilization, since it is a very important aspect in this design, because we had to calculate how much power do we need. If we have taken, let's say we are going to hover the platform in a footprint of 5 by 5 kilometer, so we should use electric motor, or we could use some different sources which we had innovated in new design ideas that we will talk about later. And we had to, of course, there might be gust winds and there might be zonal winds. We are not very sure, the environment may change. And the important aspect is that we need to keep all the aspects in mind, and we had to prevent it from harmful radiations as well. And the next parameter we had taken is the strength and resistance. It should be lightweight, durable, and cost effective, that we had talked about earlier too. And we need communication and power redundancy as well, since it is a communications payload aircraft. So it should always be available to provide a redundant system of communication, so we do not lose out this design. And the very important aspect is that it should be environment friendly. And I know why I have put up this statement, because when we started doing innovations, we came up with lots of solutions possible, but many of them were hazardous to the environment. So we had to look at that factor as well. So these are the designs we basically came up with. They had three concepts. That is, first is unmanned aerial vehicle. Second is the airship. And the third is the hybrid of airship and UAV. We call it HAIL airship, HAIL hybrid airship. So first, we'd start with the UAV design. So what we did basically, we took some existing designs of UAVs, which had similar specifications mentioned in our problem. So for example, we took Phaser 35, Zephyr T and Phantom I. And there were lot more designs. I'm mentioning only few. So we took out all the parameters. By conventional approach, we found out the optimal parameters from all these values. So for example, all three designs have maximum speed given for all three of them. So by regressive analysis, we came to an optimum value of maximum speed, empty weight, and so on. So doing this way, we came up with optimal solutions, which are listed here as such. So the velocity which we had found out would be around 35 meters per second, and all the parameters like altitude, weight, aspect ratio, we had calculated by regressive analysis. So after taking the airfoil, which is E231 airfoil, which is basically suitable for glider, which is high aspect ratio wings, we found out the lift force to be around 22,771 newtons. So we analyzed that this much lift is very much sufficient to carry the platform in the 5x5 radius, which we want to put it. So coming to the structure part, we used monocoque type fuselage since it is lightweight, durable, and it does not require much strength. So we can keep the monocoque structure and with some strength provided by ribs and spar. And the spar we have taken as cylindrical spar since it can provide us ample space to put up some avionic systems like battery, storage units, etc. And coming to the next parameter, we had taken wing shape, which in the UAV phase, we had taken it as rectangular or elliptical wing, and wing location, we had taken it high wing. And similar to a glider, we had taken the wingspan to be a very huge amount, which is 81.5 meters, and the wing chord to be around 1 meter. And considering the wing area, it was an important parameter since we were going to implement solar panels or solar photovoltaic cells. So we had to calculate a minimum amount of or maximum amount. So we can say in short that we needed to calculate a range of area so that it will be sufficient for us to put solar cells and generate ample amount of power output. So we came to a conclusion to get around 221 meters square of wing area, and which was found out to be sufficient for putting up the solar cells. And the density which we have adopted listed here is, it is taken from horizontal wind model 07, which was calculated in 2007. And the aspect ratio we calculated would be around 33. And these are all the parameters given for the wing. So lift force CL by CD, which is for the aerofoil profile. And the Reynolds number we got around was 50,000. Coming to the airfoil, this was the airfoil which we had selected. So these are the main graphs for the airfoil. Here you can see that the maximum of around 1.2 to 1.3 we are getting CL value, which we can see on the right side graph. And taking the CL by CD ratio from that graph, we can analyze that we got around 76. So coming to the next important parameter in aerodynamics, that is fuselage. So the important thing is the fuselage should be slender in shape. It should not provide a huge amount of pressure drag. So we came out to the solution that the fuselage shape should be a thin rectangular body at the aft and the elliptical forebody at the nose. And the shape of the nose, we taken it as slightly blunt or parabolic. And we had taken one vertical fin, and that was rectangular in shape. And similar for horizontal stabilizers we had taken, which was simple conventional detail. and the length was around to be fuselage length was around 48.6 meters.
Okay, so there after here we are taking over the propulsion system. So this is the toughest part when we are going to decide the propulsion system of an aircraft or something that can fly up to the lower stratospheric level. Well, looking at the problem statement, we are really thankful to the Aeronautical Society of India and IIT Bombay for giving us such a huge, mind-boggling idea to search about. Well, talking about the propulsion system, we are using at least four motors for the UAV system, and which will consume about 0.2 kilowatt each. Well, that's going to add up to 0.8 kilowatt. And using this motor and utilizing the power for, again, repowering the whole system, because we know that the propulsion system is going to provide the electric as well as taking the flight to that height, maintain everything in it. So it will consume as well as it will serve. So redesigning these parameters took us to various aspects, and selecting three among the all these parameters, we have went through literature reviews and selected six, that CIGS, copper, indium, gallium, selenide, and that is a photovoltaic cell we will mount on the surface of the aircraft. Next is the impulse turbine, that is an innovation, and we will talk about it, how it is working. Actually, it's picking up the RAM air over there because the stratospheric level has a very smooth airflow, and we can catch that, generate to electricity. Then the third, we have the regenerative fuel cells, that is lithium ion batteries, to store whatever charges we get from it. Later, I will discuss. And we also have the secondary storage devices to store extra power, because see, we are going to have three different sources to generate power, and we will have ample power to store itself also, even after giving to the payload. So going on, here we can see that three pictures are there, one with the schematic diagram, another with the wing platform mounted with the impulse turbine beneath it. We first try to make the placement of the turbine at the belly of the aircraft, but then due to some discharge parameters, means float separations, we placed it near the turbine itself, the motor itself, to catch the RAM air smoothly. Then we have the schematic diagram stating the wick discharge collector. So whenever you will travel in the aircraft and peeping out from the window seat, you can see few of the wicks projecting outward from the winglets, especially. And those are nothing but discharging eddy currents developed by the surface of the aircraft due to skin friction drag. So those charges can be collected. And we are really thankful that Roscosmos once invented this thing while they were searching for several satellite re-atmospheric entry thing. So what we are going to have is the whole parameter bound up to integrate a system which can take and give electric power supply to all the system. Because see, we cannot have conventional fuel for charging these systems. We cannot take much fuel inside the plane. It will be heavier. So we decided for non-conventional sources and so on. Moving on. We have this diagram, and we can see that how we are going to distribute the output. Well, the output can be taken by the electric motor, of course, to run the aircraft, and the ample amount will be stored inside the storage devices. And in the sense of when the aircraft is moving, it will collect the airflow, and that will move through the turbine to generate some of the charges again that will be stored in the energy devices, or it will be utilized on the very spot. We have that system also. We will talk about it. Moving on, we have different systems.
Sudha, your voice is not audible.
Okay, so the fuselage, is it audible now? Hello?
Yeah, it is audible now. Yes, dear.
Okay, so the fuser structure, as we decided, will be the monocoque structure. And why this? Why is this reason for being the monocoque? We can have the other structures like full sail body structures where we can have truss structures. But see, monocoque has a really special feature that it can distribute its load. It can distribute the shear flow diagram if we talk more engineerical. And so we can have a perfect structure when it is a monocoque structure. We can have,
which is used in the internal structure. Titanium is considered to be high temperature material, but but titanium also have different grades, like 4 grade, 5 grade. So we have used, as we have long wing structure that we have. So we have used it because it has high strength to weight ratio and it is corrosion resistant. And we have used stainless steel for covering the hinges parts and other parts where we have more load and make it corrosion resistive. Next, please. So for the covering of wings and body, we have used carbon fiber reinforced composite, which is good and lightweight. And for the propellers, we have used inconel, which has high density. Next. This is the rough sketch of our final design of UAV.
Gurveer, your voice is not audible.
Hello, sir, is my voice audible now?
Yes, dear, yes.
Sir, so I would like to take over for the simulation results from now. We did simulation in SimScape, which is an online simulation software. And after porting it through the K-epsilon based simulation, we found out that these are the parameters we had taken. So we took the mesh as hex dominant mesh, and the number of intersected edges and number of edges are shown as such, which is basically the elements and nodes shown here. So on the right hand side, you can see the graph that the pressure value, which is very important since we took it as important concern. So we used as you can see, the residual value, which shows that after so much iterations, the pressure started to drop, which is a good sign. So next comes the second concept, which is concept of airship. So following the similar approach we used in UAV design, we took up for similar airships as well. So we looked up some airships which have high endurance and which have high range as well. So we found out that these designs, we also took 6 to 7 designs, but we are mentioning only a few, like Stratobus, Lockheed Martin HALE-D, and integrated system with structure airship. So after comparing all the designs, we following the similar approach, we found out the optimal values. And the first important thing that comes in the airship is the fuselage shape, which is the only important thing, since the fuselage shape is responsible for providing the aerodynamic lift plus the buoyant lift, which is which we get from the lifting gas. So literature survey we had done from the fundamentals of aircraft and airship design, we took the inference that the fuselage shape, which have medium tail, or you can say the CD naught value for the fineness ratio of 6, it was the least. So we selected the fineness ratio to be 6. And talking about the vertical and the horizontal fins, since in the right hand side, we can see that the comparison of CD versus angle of attack for different configurations of fins. So here we can clearly see that this drag value is the least for the X configuration plane. So we
took the X configuration plane and we moved on with it. And coming to the structure part, we have taken the semi-rigid airship because as we know that rigid airship is relatively heavier and we have to provide some ample strength to it also. So we took the truss type semi-rigid airship. And so here we can see that the best configuration for an airship fuselage body would be ellipsoid in the front, cylindrical in the middle and paraboloid at the end. Paraboloid, why? Because we need to satisfy the Kutta condition also. And here you can clearly see the CP profile, which is mentioned here. And on the right hand side, we can see that the configuration on the lowest one, so which is the square box you can see, which is meant for fineness ratio of 6. So here it is clearly visible that for Reynolds, as Reynolds number is increasing, so CD naught value is least for the fineness ratio 6. So we took on the fineness ratio 6 and we went on completing further calculation stages. So as mentioned that here on the histogram, we can see that the CD naught and the CL alpha value, the optimal parameters is for the X configuration, all others had the CD by CL ratio, which was very high. So we had to take the optimum value. So we decided to move on with X configuration. And since it has X configuration, the upper two parts can be exposed to the sunlight irradiation environment. So we can also think of implementing solar cells over there. So that was also our thinking behind using this configuration as well. So since we know that airships are not very effective in maneuver or effective in controlling, so we can implement high lift devices on the X configuration, X configuration fins, and so that we can control it in the yaw moment and pitch moment.
Talking about the propulsive system, we have the airship in a very absurd manner, that is conical at the backside and the oblong huge body in the front side. So of course we can see that the lift generation will be greater in the front side and it will be like a balloon at the end of the day. But we need to have it like a platform, right? So we are going to place the propellers and propulsive units at the rear end so that we can produce some of the lifts to balance the moments. So we are going to use again the four motors with this time 1 kW payload is continuously given to the payload sections. That is contiguous, more of telling it to be continuous. So propeller will be again consuming the same power input, that is 0.2 kilowatt, and four will be there, so 0.8 kilowatt. The ample amount of energy generated by the ramp air can be stored again in the form of the energy store units, the secondary energy store unit, as stated by Rajmans. We have different cells. Moving on, we have three consumption units, that is the electric motor that is going to have the propulsive unit and the switch combinations which will switch which motor will be running so that we can do maneuver, because maneuverability is again dependent on the propulsive system in case of the airship. In our case, well, optional switches of on and off system, this will be continuously monitored by onboard Internet of Things IoT systems and microcontrollers over there, because it is unmanned aircraft. And so solar cells and electric conversion, that will be monitored, what charges are being collected. Either we can depend on the solar cell for continuously running of the propulsive unit, or we have to go for the impulse turbine generation part. See, we when the impulse turbine is generated in the belly of the fuselage of the airship, we are monitoring that the separation layer are enough to charge upon 2.5 kilowatt and 0.8 kilowatt at each kilometer, so that is enough to propel the electric motors and the propulsive unit. So the surplus energy we are generating from the solar cell can be stored in the RFCs, the regenerative fuel cells. This is how we are going to use our propulsive system and as well as serving the several electronics and avionics inside. Next. And this is how the impulse turbine parameters are being calculated. As we told you that we are going to collect the ramp air. So of course the M dot, that is mass flow rate, is a factor, and air density is a matter over there. So reduction gear teeth, because ramjet air can only rotate the turbine in very minimal speed. And if we are going to use the teeth over there, the gearing mechanisms, we can have more torque. So shaft input can be calculated. The general formulas are given. The research parameters are again with us only. Well, output, and this in this way, we can calculate the power input by power output and have the efficiency, which was near about 82% at that, because stratospheric level has a very stable air, and if ramjet can collect all these things. Moving on.
Sudha, your mic is muted.
This section will be taken over by Subham CD actually.
So, am I audible now?
Yes, Subham is.
Since we are already having lightweight and durable structure requirement, so we would use the keel or truss type structure that would provide the required amount of strength as well as durability. So why do we select semi-rigid airship? Since we have to take in mind, we have to carry 100 kg payload along with it all the time. And one more thing is that the requirement of easy takeoff and landing, that is also an important parameter in designing conceptual aircraft. So keeping all these things in mind, we need a lightweight and a durable strength. So we had to go on with the semi-rigid structure. Talking about the empennage. So empennage has a very shorter length, and since there would be very less loading due to lift, so we don't require very much strength to the structure. So only the skeleton structure will be sufficient for the work.
In airship, materials play a very important role. So for the hull of the airship, we have choose two materials, that is nylon polyamide and Dacron polyester, which has density of 0.042 and 0.052 respectively. During nylon, polyamide has peak strain of 40, whereas Dacron has 80. So we used nylon polyamides as a hull of the airship, and thereafter we have used Tenax, which is a chemical material which protects the material nylon polyamide from the UV rays, and we have used in carbon and aluminium rods in the internal structure according to the requirements, and titanium A1 because the length of airship is more. So when we don't have the type of payload, for example, if it is a point load or gradually varying load, so we have used titanium so that it can withstand any type of load. So thereafter we have used in the aluminium in the internal structure of the wings and fuselage. Next, please.
I'll be continuing from here. So again, since it would be using some power storage unit and power consumption would be there, again we would be using the batteries as well as the solar panels. But from the previous one, we kept in mind that the covering of the solar panels is same as the from the previous one, that is 13.424 square meters to 290 around square meters. But while we were doing this project, we came to a problem where airship doesn't have a good maneuverability, so we looked upon some solutions, because if might there would be a aircraft coming, or if there is something, a rocket launch or anything could be there. So we came to a conclusion, or sort of we find it of something, that we install a proximity sensors, which would be using LiDAR kind of stuff, which would be sending rays at in all the direction. And if suppose there's some obstruction or any problem in the way, it would be diverting from its main path and would be choosing a better optimal path. And this whole thing would be done automatically. Next slide, please. And one more thing, since the there is evening and morning, so there would be a tilt in the rays from the sun. So we took some help of software, which would help us to get the optimum value of the irradiance which would be getting on the solar panels. Next slide, please. And Sudha would be taking over.
Okay, we will be talking about the redundancy systems after this slide.
Should we change the slide?
Thank you. The redundancy system. Well, airship as being is a very less maneuverable ship or aircraft structure, we can consider that we don't have to bother about it after it is being launched. Well, that's a tremendous statement we have just made. Well, what to do over here is that we are considered the FLARM system taken from the European centers, currently being used in Rega helicopters right now. And we are not going to bother the ATC or the other systems, like we are going to use the LiDAR also. But this FLARM system, let me tell you about something it has special that, please go into next slide. So this is LX FLARM, the Red Box Remote Transceivers Unit. What is actually has, we can have our own database, flight data recorder, and cockpit voice. Because cockpit voice data is not there, we have the flight data recorder. Well, the SD card is present over there. It can record the last moment of flight and everything in the pitch, the yaw, the rolling forces it is having on it. And of course, it will be maintaining a proper distance from each and every aircraft. If although it is flying its own altitude, or it is going above, going down, whatever it is doing, it will be monitoring even the drones, even the birds. It will be collecting all those data so that we can have a proper distance from each and every corner. This is only one system, which is the combination of airborne collision detection and awareness system, as well as LiDAR system. We have redundancy for the LiDAR also, that will be given by the firm. And the weight is not as much as the LiDAR. It is again reduced by the 50%. So we decided to include this inside the airship. Moving on, the next will be taken care by my teammates.
So after having all these ideas, we were like, let's make the drawing now, initial drawings. So we use a software called Shaper 3D that's available on iPads. So we went there and we jotted down all the points, as we said that it should consider the Kutta conditions, it should have such a spread of solar cells and all these things. We came to this conclusion that the four motors would be placed in such a way. You could see the color like a greenish tint. The motors are placed there, while the solar panel is placed at the top with a blackish tint. And while to keep the whole system cool enough for
took the Cape Silent model for the airship model, and here on the left hand side you can see the pressure contour. So on the nose cone of the part, you can see that the maximum pressure, which is around 8.2 e plus 0.2. So which, after analyzing that, we came to find out that the pressure distribution is not very much evenly distributed. So since we have used the triangular element, and the nodes and elements are shown as such, and on the right hand side you can see on the different iterations, which we had around 50 iterations, and it shows the pressure distribution. and these are the temperature and shear contours. Why it is important? Because we had to assess all the parameters. Since temperature is important, because the avionics and the other components, which are like secondary storage devices, which are placed inside, we had to keep in mind how much temperature would be at every point on the platform, so that we can keep it sustainable and it in a perfect place. So the temperature we had taken it around. Of course, we got the maximum temperature at the nose part and the least values just after that. But it was considered that the temperature is evenly distributed. And on the right hand side, you can see the wall shear contour, which shows that the skin friction drag, how much would it be? So taking a rough approximation on mean values, so we can easily say that the drag, it is little bit more at the nose part and slightly at the ram air inlet part, but moreover it is evenly distributed, so we can count on it. Coming to the next last phase of our hybrid of airship and UAV. So the first question is, why did we have to go on with such design? So it is basically a mixture of airship and UAV. We had taken the wing structure from the UAV and the fuselage structure of airship, and the first important thing is that we had to analyze what are the challenges. So after analyzing the challenges, the main challenges we faced was UAV, which had the limitations in range. It cannot go very far off. And the airship, of course, it had the limitations in controllability and maneuverability. So to cater those problems, we had to come up with a third solution. So the third solution which we implemented had some minor changes, such as we added taper wing so that we can evenly distribute the load on the wing. That's how we got the minimum wing loading, and putting the wing in the mid section instead of the high wing section. So, and the one important thing which we had added is the VTOL mechanism with two electrical retraction propellers mechanism, which could be used both in cruise mode as well as the takeoff mode. So next is the lift. The amount of lift we had calculated after thorough analysis and calculations, we found out that the wing, which had around aspect ratio of 10, it would produce around 16,289 newtons lift, and the lifting gas using helium gas as the lifting gas, and the volume to be around 30,000 cubic meters, we would produce around 9,667 newtons of lift from the lifting gas itself. So coming to the structures part, we had to come up with an innovative solution, since there is no such structure existing in market. So we had to think of our own structure. So we came up with an innovative solution that we could use a circular truss, which is very much new. Since we need to put our wing on the structure, on the body of the fuselage, so therefore we require a circular truss structure, which can be seen on the top right side. And for the body, for the base of the fuselage, you can use a keel type or truss type structure. Coming to the materials, why material is important? Because since we know that there would be variations with temperature and there would be variations with pressure and so on, so we had to choose our materials very wisely. So of course, the materials would be dominated by carbon fiber and glass fiber composites, but at some places, as mentioned by our friend, we need ample amount of strength as well as rigidity. For example, at the leading edge portions or the wing, which is very huge aspect ratio, so it might occur that it has some aeroelastic issues. So at some certain points, not very much, we can use titanium. It is a high temperature material, but to provide some strength, since it is a high strength to weight ratio, the problem with carbon fiber is that it is brittle in nature, so it might break easily. So therefore, we can provide a titanium materials, and we can also use aluminium. And for the skin of the fuselage, for the body, we can use nylon 6,6 polyamide fiber. And for covering the fuselage from harmful radiations, we could use the Tenox material, which was mentioned by my friend. So coming to the wing, we already mentioned that we would be using mid-winged tapered wing, and the span to be around 39.8 meters. And the same aerofoil which we would be using, which is E231I1, and the area of the wing was calculated to be around 158 meters, and the CL which you had taken for airfoil would be around 1.2, and the lift which generated from the wing was 16,289 newtons. Talking about the fuselage, it is similar to the phase two of airship that we had taken. The same concepts we had applied here too. So that is fuselage ratio we had taken 6. The CD value for the fuselage shape, so that came from the inference taken from the fundamentals of aircraft and airship. So we took the CD value to be 0.03 and CL to be 0.006. And these are all the parameters as such. And since we had implemented a rectangular body at the aft and elliptical body forward at the nose, so we are implementing the same shape of the fuselage as we had used in the airship design. And the volume which we can see here is 33,983 cubic meters, which is sufficient to provide ample amount of lifting gas to produce required lift. So coming to the stability and control part, it is very important parameters. Since we have to maneuver it as well, since we have to make some flight profile, and the flight profile we had considered is a it would hover or loiter in a 5 by 5 kilometers cube in the stratosphere region. So it should have a control surfaces, of course. So the X configuration fins which we are using, it could be used as ailerons input at the primary wing. So since we have a hybrid airship, we can use the ailerons for rolling roll motions, and in the lateral motions we can use the rudder and lateral motions we can use the yaw inputs and rudder for the left and right motion of the platform. So this is the important static stability and control part. And the next thing that we assess is the horizontal wind model. So that is important. Why? Because we had to account for the gust and the heat flux. That is the major issue in the stratosphere region, since it keeps on changing based on the climate and the humidity of the location. So after selecting and analyzing the horizontal wind model, we came up to a solution that these are the parameters that are in as such in the amount of zonal wind and the behavior of winds that was assessed from there. So after assessing, we found out that the VTOL that would be better, because simple propellers would not be very much efficient just for cruising, because we need to take off as well. So it would just take off for once, but we need to put it in such a way that we would reduce the complexities of the design. So the single thing can do multiple sorts of work. So it's kind of a multitasking job. So my friend Sudha will take over from here.
Sure. And here we are coming to the change in propulsion system. Up to this point, we are considering only 4 motors and for UAV as well as for airship. Sorry, I'm meeting for a second. Yeah, actually the bus is there. So, okay, fine. So what we are having over here is the 2 propeller system in this hybrid airship. Why 2? We are going to save some of the input energy, first of all. Okay, and the next thing is that if we compare the shape of the airship and the hybrid airship, we can see that we are not only having the oblonged shape right now, we are having a perfect oval, right? So we are balancing the lift forces, so we don't need any propeller to balance the rear end of the spaceship, airship. So we are having the propellers just beneath the wing, and we are going to use the tilt rotors. As Shivam sir told us that we are going to use the VTOL as well as the cruising mechanism by only one thing. So we have this tilt rotor over here. And thus saving by the tilt rotor's energy input, we are going to utilize twice as much the power we can utilize for the 4 rotors. So we are having more power than the previous models. Moving on. Again, we are talking about the impulse turbine generator, the innovation we did. Actually, what happens over here, we are having more power for the propulsive unit. So we are going to have more thrust. More thrust means we are going to have more RAM air input, then RAM air input is more, we can rotate the turbine is much more greater rate. And that's how we are getting the, by analysis of horizontal wind model and comparing the data, we are getting an input of a turbine RPM to be 47,746.438 to be precise. And the power generation output is increased by 1.5 kilowatt. That is huge. Okay, fine. Power input is 5 kilowatt. That's good. For the initial parameters, it is. But again, we are going to input some of our other generative cells, photovoltaic cells and all. So discussing about the air intake density at that height is 1.184 kg per meter cube. And the mass flow rate calculating the rho AV formula, we are having 84.355 kg per second. 55% of the maximum efficiency for impulse turbine as stated by the Boyes et al. And the gear theta ratio is 2.0. That is very efficient one. The twice as we can say. Moving on, we are taken over by Shivam Suri, sir.
So coming to the structures part of the hybrid design. So I will talk about the fuselage first. By using the keel structure, we have reduced the width of the 25% of diameter of fuselage, and which is very useful since we can implement a smaller design. We do not require a very long airship, since simple smaller around 48 meters of fuselage would be able to do the job. So we have taken into consideration that by reducing the keel width, we can reduce the weight also, and we could implement we could reduce the loading of the platform. Talking about the wings. So the wing, which is very important in this hybrid design. So the I-shaped spar, which we have selected, since we already know that it provides high strength to weight ratio. And in contrast to using a cylindrical spar in UAV, that had a linear structure. So it has less harm for fatigue deformation, which is very important in case of wings, which would be put into fatigue cases, like there would be a lot of flutterings since it might travel at around 33 to 40 meter per second speed. So here we can see the empennage structure. So as we have already mentioned that we had to go on work with some innovation in structural design as well. So here you can clearly see the picture on the left hand side in the front view, that a circular truss structure, which we have put hand-drawn design. So it would support the wing, and beside the circular truss, we could have a keel or truss type structure for the base of the fuselage. And on the right side, on the side view, you can clearly see how the keel structure look like. So which is important that the structure we are implementing should be a honeycomb sandwich structure, because it has been already in research, and we had inferred from there that it provides optimal strength and reduced weight. And now my friend Gurveer would like to take over.
So coming to the materials for hybrid airship, we have similar materials as we have in airship. For example, nylon polyamide, which is used for the hull of the airship, as well as hybrid airship, and thin layer of tanox. And we have used carbon and aluminium rod inside this structure. And titanium we have used in the wing structure, as we have cantilever type of structure in the wing. So we have also placed solar panel above it. So there might be loads that can affect. So we have used material which have very high strength to weight ratio, and we have used aluminium 5052 and 7075, which have density 2680 and 2810. So in the internal structure of wings and the fuselage, and we have also used titanium in the nose of the hybrid airship. Next, please. So these are the materials fraction we have got. It is approximate. So we have used 59% of composite material in the wings, and 10% of other materials, and we have used 6% aluminium and 31% of titanium. And thereafter in empennage, we have used 20% of titanium, 10% of aluminium and 65% of composite and other materials 5%. Thereafter, we have used in the fuselage we have used 21% of nylon polyamide and titanium of 21% and composite of 25%. Next, please. And now I am handing over to Mr. Rajwansh.
So again, the problem was to power it. So as I was saying that we are using solar cells as well as the regenerative fuel cells with the impulse turbine. So with the photovoltaic cells, we could withstand all the current requirements that we that is needed for our flight. So in the morning, they would be charging for the whole day, starting from the morning to the evening. And at night, they would be using the impulse turbine as the energy stored in the batteries. So the batteries which we saw were kind of different one. So they were like we once saw a battery which was made of silicon. But the silicon, like silicon and some alloy was there. So, but that was not performing very well, and it was in development for more than around 8 years now. So we skipped that one, and we built it in such a way that the framework must carry all the buoyant forces, like if there is some gust or anything. So. It would take all the loads and would be carrying on with the whole stuff. Please change. And again, this diagram we came to all after all the discussion and final editing and everything, we came to this design which shows how the solar panels are placed as well as where the motors are placed. So this whole diagram was built on Shaper 3D.
Sorry for the internet connectivity issue. So my friend was saying that the design which was modeled in Shaper 3D. So in here we are showing that the solar cells that could be implemented on the top of the fuselage as well as on the wing structure. And second, on the side view, it shows us that how the propeller electric propeller unit would be implemented on the wing. And here you can see that it is a mid-wing aircraft. And on the nose part that we have mentioned, below the nose, just below the nose, we have implemented the impeller turbine duct, which is for ram air intake. And this is the front view in which you can see the comparison of the propeller size and the fuselage shape. So talking about the simulation results of hybrid, so we took out the temperature, velocity and pressure contours. So we found out that in comparison with the airship model, we were satisfied with the results since it has even distribution of pressure and velocity. So we used the K epsilon model and the element type was triangular and the nodes and elements are shown here. So these are the results, and this is also showing the pressure and temperature contour. So we can clearly see the temperature contour, which is high maximum at the inlet duct front, and the pressure is also maximum there. So after calculations, we found out that the density that we would get is maximum at the inlet ram air inlet duct. So now my friend Sudha will take over from here.
So coming to the conclusions and comparison and result, we are having a portion called lens comparison. Talking about it, lens comparison is like comparing a body with respect to the other one. Like I'm looking at A with respect to B and looking at B with respect to C. Okay, so this kind of comparison, why this kind of comparison? Because we are having three models. First UAV, then airship, after that hybrid of them. So we have to compare the hybrid with respect to UAV as well as with respect to airship. Now, moving on to the airship with respect to UAV, we found that airship is better. Okay, then we are going to have the hybrid with respect to airship. So this is the chart which is presented here as an optimized result for the simulation after we got it. This is telling us the red line having the pressure hybrid and the blue line being the pressure of airship. Normal. So we can see that the hybrid has only one peak at the edge of 8 × 10^2. And the airship is having two peaks in general. So what we have is that we are optimizing the pressure ratio, because airship, if we remember the shape of the airship, we can see the Kutajkowski theorem following up. We are having a pointed tail and we are having a huge difference of pressure. That's why two peaks. And for the hybrid portion, we are having only one peak, which is really, we can say it is like a sine wave. If we can plot a contour over the peaks. So this is how we are optimized with the results. And the future scopes are like, we have created such innovations and it creates a huge broad aspects of motivating and other people to join us and do something more on it. Well, better computation design parameters can be helping us more, just because we are using the SimScale operation in the computer. More with the ANSYS and more accurate data with NASA and ISRO softwares can improve the results also. We can have precise data values. Well, behavioral study of the materials at high altitude, we are not available with the data right now with the because much of the experiment are considered inside the stratosphere and very less data are available. We cannot refer as a stagnant data for this thing. If we are having such data, we can, of course, apply it. Okay, and the wind model we applied was generated in 2007. Later, the wind models are not implemented for the Indian subcontinent and the Asia-Pacific region. So we are again lagging behind in that shape. If somebody has this parameter, we can always apply that. Rotating solar panel is something that we have came across while searching about all this technology. But again, implementing these things would be needing a much structural behavior of the spacesuit and add weight. But we need to meet the circumstances of hanging it around above the 20 kilometer for 1 year. Well, we can look on to this aspect also. And of course, the smart materials or the bending blended bodies can be done. Morphing can be implemented. These are the overall factors. Well, moving on. So, next slide, please. So, we went through actually our result contents and the research paper contains about 82 to 85 pages. And the last three pages are full of references. Well, I'm really thankful to the Leland M. Nicolai for publishing the book of Fundamentals of Aircraft and Airship Design. This is really awesome book and can give us each and everything for designing airship. Well, I'm really thankful to him and really thankful to Rajkumar Esman, professor in the aerospace department, IIT Bombay. He has done a huge amount of research in this thing. His research papers are really high impact factors and really good. I'm really thankful to the JAXA and Aerocosmos for developing the VIX discharge systems. Where the FLARM Society and the Soaring Society of America, SSA, strongly for the LX red box systems. And again, some of the research papers from Japan and some of the research papers from Europe are really helpful. I am really thankful to Gonzalo Hernandez and John Natto for his contribution in the horizontal wind model. And Douglas P. Drob, he was the one to measure all these parameters. And this is how we got our right now the HELP or HEL UAV. So next thing. So this is how we have our model taking off from one city, going around, and coverage of 5 by 5 kilometer for 3 months, and then moving on for the next destination, and again for 3 months, it will be having a 5 by 5 footprint revolving over there. In this way, a platform which was never been imagined to have an endurance of 1 year can be made into practical form at least. Thank you. And now we are open for any questions. If you want to have an open session, we can take your questions.
Aishwarya ma'am, kindly proceed with the questions.
Okay. I would like to take that question. Well, for designing the future airship, I would suggest that you refer to the Nikolai's book as well, because he bent it into a really nice manner. And please consider the higher models of horizontal wind model. We have done it with the 2007 model. And of course, you will get it for US standards. But for developing for India and indigenous technology, please have a reference from something from Asia Pacific region at least. And designing an airship is still a huge amount of job and a risk-taking and breathtaking moment when you launch it. Well, please consider the safety factors as much as possible. And the engineering safety factor is really important in case of airships. Anybody, the floor is open to our team members if anybody wants to add.
So for the future aspects, we could also see the morphing of the wings. That's a new technology which is coming up. Research is, of course, going on. And we could implement that system to our system too. Suppose for the given situation, if the aircraft have to move faster, but the propulsion system is going to its limit. So we could change the shape of the whole structure so that it increases its speed and the whole efficiency remains up. So that's a point of research for us now.
Yes, I would like to take that question. So the first important parameter in CFD analysis is that first we need to put our mind in crystal clear concept that what would be our design be. But since it is a conceptual phase, we can sort of think of implementing new ideas since it does not require very much cost. So starting from the design phase, so the problem which has been given to us by the customer or by the challenge. So taking into consideration that how much would be the weight of the structure, that is the first parameter that eventually the weight estimation that eventually decides the shape and the structure of the body. So which in turn leads to deciding the aerodynamics of the fuselage and the wing. So as we have talked earlier that we took some analysis in X-File software and we changed the airfoils and we came up with a optimal solution. So we selected E231 airfoil, let's say. So after analyzing it in the softwares, we found out that the optimal values of coefficient of lift, or we can say the maximum amount of lift force we are getting. So that was E231 airfoil. So we selected that airfoil and we went on with it. So in such a manner that we did research and we did n number of simulations, and in out of all those simulations, we found out the satisfying criteria for optimal values. So that is the important parameter that how we should go on for the CFD simulation.
If I would like to take this question, will FLARM or LX-FLARM lead box system is a combination of LIDAR as well as the system which will monitor each and every object nearby? Well, this is not like you are thinking the developed by the Lockheed Martin or something like a relevance of military technique. Well, it is just used for detecting any piece of object near you. It's just kind of detecting waves generated by that object or something, sound, any kind of disturbance in the air or any kind of temperature difference. It will notice that and judge that object, whether it is a operational avionics system or whether it is a natural system like a bird or something. It will give you notification according to that. And it is being developed by FLARM Technologies itself and currently being used in Rega helicopters. So this is a system which can replace a LIDAR in the future scopes, I think so. And though it is not in the recent platforms, but soon you will see these things into the world of aviation.
I'd like to take that question. So the solar panels are attached on the surface of the cloth or the material which we are using. That would be stitched, but not literally stitched, but that would be fixed to that material. And the as if we were showing that the structure at the central part and the hull which we have made. So strength to take over that whole material. When you are placing the solar panels or the wings, we have got rib structures in it, which would be taking up the load of the solar panels. And as well as the material is, of course, there, which would be taking up all the load, and the solar panels would be attached in that manner.
I would like to add one point on this thing. That is, we are using the CIGS technology for the solar panel, and we are not using the rigid one. We need to consider the camber shape, right? So we are having a mono solar panel. There are two kinds of solar panel, mono and poly. So we are having the mono, which can have the maximum efficiency, and it can be stretchable like a sheet. So we just keep it like a sheet over the wing, determining the millimeter of thickness, and we embed it in on the solar airship.
So I would like to take that question. So actually there is a correction. It is not 137 kgs. It is 1327 kgs. So which is around 1320 kgs. And of course, yes, it includes the payload. And the payload, which is around 100 kgs, it is already covered. So that is the answer, I guess.
Okay. Thank you. I would like to ask Nehru sir to give a few words about the project work which the students have.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Nehru sir, yes, it is audible.
Yeah. That was a very wonderful lecture. I would like to thank Mr. Shivam, Mr. Gurveer Singh, and as well as Mr. Rajwans and Mr. Chaudhary and his friends for giving their work. It was like, yesterday we had a lecture where we were talking about virtual tour of International Space Station. I think today is also some kind of virtual interaction. In fact, we have seen how to build up the vehicle, and what about the batteries and how the problems, I mean, various issues and how the troubleshooting will be done, and everything was shown in a beautiful way. And we will look forward for one more lecture. I think tomorrow, could you please explain the topic for tomorrow's lecture?
There is a lecture topic is NASA's aerospace open software, so which will be used to design and analyze aerospace vehicles. So that lecture was
okay. I think those softwares can also be used for seeing, getting some data regarding the astronomical units or something like International Space Station.
Some softwares are related with astronomy. Most will be related with the aerospace science. So
Okay. Some topics like, you know, how to locate the International Space Station. I think there are certain apps for that also.
Yes, we will discuss that also. That if you
That part will be interesting for the student community. Sure. Mostly.
We will take that also.
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
And I on behalf of Kurukshetra Panorama and Science Center, I would once again thank Mr. Ponma Kishan as well as Ms. Aishwarya Dhara and all the team members like Mr. Rajwansh Chaudhary and then Gurvin Singh and Shivam for giving a awesome lecture, and we will look forward. So we will be joining tomorrow same time at 6 o'clock in the evening. So
yes.
With that, we will be signing off.
From our end also, we are thanking Kurukshetra Panorama and Nehru sir for providing this wonderful opportunity for us. Thank you, sir. We can wind up.
Welcome.
Okay.